Good morning. Welcome to everyone. Good to be here. If you're visiting, we're especially thankful for your presence. A pleasure to get to meet you and to worship together. This is the time of year when, of course, schools are getting back into session. Our local schools are pretty much there already, but the institutions of higher learning are just now getting geared up. I know we have had several traveling the last few days getting students back to school. We have more of that coming up this week, so let's keep those folks in our thoughts and prayers, and especially those students, especially the freshmen heading off away from home to live away from home for the first time. It's a big change in the life of an entire family, not only the student who's looking forward to it and the parents who may be dreading it, but let's keep them in our prayers, and all of our students will have a good year in school. In any relationship, there will be conflict. It doesn't matter if it's a relationship involving two people or 2,000 people. There will be conflict. Some of those conflicts will be extremely minor. These are things that aren't worth mentioning. We don't even spend much time dealing with them. But still, technically, they qualify as conflict. And then there may be conflicts that are extremely significant. Things that have to be dealt with for the relationship to survive and remain healthy. All relationships involve some level of conflict. Conflicts come in many different forms. They can be misunderstandings that are resolved with nothing more than clearer communication. They can be genuine offenses, where someone does something that truly offends someone else. Or the conflict may be something that someone does that someone else disapproves of. These can involve doctrinal issues, moral issues, all kinds of things. And not every conflict is a crisis situation. It just means that people don't always agree with each other on everything. Any group of people of any size involves an incalculable number of relationships. And each of those relationships has the potential for conflict. And the church is no exception. In the church, we have enough things in common that hopefully the conflicts are reduced in both nature and number. Because we share beliefs and values and a commitment to Christ, we have fewer conflicts than if we didn't share basic values and beliefs. But we will still have conflict. It would be nice to think that in the church, because we are all Christians, there would never be any conflicts. And because conflict would never arise in the church, this conflict-free utopia would be our beacon to the world. That people would be drawn to this conflict-free group of people. It would be as if Jesus had said, "By this all will know that you are my disciples, because there will never be any conflicts among you." But realistically, we know that that's not the way it works. And that's not what Jesus said. He said, "By this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another." In John chapter 13, verse 35. Love doesn't totally remove all conflict, but it should dominate how we deal with conflict. Jesus did not expect his church to be totally free of conflict. If he did, the story of the early church as told in the book of Acts would have been a great disappointment to him. The early church did not impact the world because the members were never in conflict with each other. But part of their impact on the world did grow from the way they dealt with conflict. And the way they treated each other when conflict arose. Christians will disagree with each other at times. The New Testament makes no attempt to pretend otherwise. We will have misunderstandings by which we offend each other. Christians will do wrong things that will oblige other Christians to confront and correct the wrongdoer. When such things happen, and they will happen, we can let our light shine if we deal with conflict according to the instructions of Scripture. How Christians treat each other in times of conflict can be one of the most powerful demonstrations we have of lives that are transformed by Christ. The New Testament gives us general principles as well as practical instructions to guide us in correcting each other and in dealing with conflict. Biblical instructions about resolving conflict are every bit as binding as any other commandment or doctrine in the Bible. And because I've had the last couple of Sundays off, we've had a little bit of a break in this series of lessons on His Church is My Church. So we're going to do a little review of the main general theme of these lessons. The principles that we have covered in this series of lessons, in those earlier lessons, create what we have called the environment of a local congregation. That environment is extremely important when conflict arises and we have to deal with it. If a healthy environment hasn't been created during times of peace and tranquility, it will be extra difficult to deal with conflict in the way that God wants when it does arise. This environment is one in which members are aware of their connection with each other. It's an environment where members care for the body and care for the other members of the body. Under this idea of His church is my church, each member is responsible for promoting and preserving this healthy environment. Each member is responsible for not being the cause of the conflict. And when there is conflict, each member is responsible for maintaining the environment in which the conflict can be resolved with the least amount of hurt done to the body or to other members of the body. If His church is my church, we might not all have the same role to play in a given situation, but we all have a role to play in caring for each other and in caring for the body. There are two or three passages of Scripture that really focus on the nature of the church, on the purpose of the church, and on the environment that is to prevail in the church. A key passage in this series has been Ephesians chapter 4. In Ephesians chapter 4, Paul describes the calling of a Christian in the specific context of a congregation of Christians. He starts with a call to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. And in describing that call, we might have expected Paul to focus on a Christian's relationship with God, to see the call in that vertical sense. For example, he might have written about the importance of prayer, the need to maintain and develop one's relationship with God through that avenue of communication called prayer could have been his main point. And it would have been an appropriate discussion. But that's not where Paul went. Or he could have written about proper worship. We should express our relationship with God through worship and praise and sacrifice. And he does eventually write about praising and thanking God in song over in chapter 5. But even there, he sets that praise and thanksgiving in the context of speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. For Paul, the walk worthy of our calling is being a faithful member among many members of the body of Christ. He says we are to bear with one another in love. We keep the unity of the Spirit, which is more than just one person united with God. It is members of the body united with God. He goes on to describe the worthy walk as one where members equip each other for ministry, where members help each other grow to spiritual maturity, where each member does its part to build a healthy and loving body of Christians. Another key passage that we've looked at is the great body analogy in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And the message of 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is very much the same message as in Ephesians chapter 4. The difference is that Ephesians 4 is more of a literal description of how members of the body work with and for each other. 1 Corinthians 12 presents the same idea, but it stays with the metaphor of the human body. But the message is still the important role of each member for the well-being of the body. One member of the body cannot be sick, cannot be hurt, cannot misbehave without bringing the sickness or the hurt or the misbehavior into the life of the body. When the thumb is smashed, the mouth cries out in pain. When the thumb heals, the whole body feels better and functions better. When there is conflict in the body, or between members of the body, this complex of interwoven relationships comes into play. Some members might be more directly involved than others in addressing that conflict, but everyone is touched by it. Everyone has an interest in seeing the conflict resolved in the best possible way. And if we take passages such as Ephesians 4 and 1 Corinthians 12 together, we still don't have a detailed set of instructions for dealing with all kinds or any kind or every kind of conflict. But if these passages guide our general church life, we will have an environment where, one, the quantity of conflict is reduced. But maybe more important, these passages help us to create a healthy environment where conflict can be addressed and resolved in a way that is worthy of our calling. In Galatians chapter 6, Paul applies the environment described in Ephesians 4 to the specific issue of resolving conflict. I'll reread part of the passage that Garrett read for us a moment ago, Galatians 6, 1, 2, and 3. Brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself lest you also be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Note how similar the ideas of those three verses in Galatians 6 are to Ephesians chapter 4. In Ephesians chapter 4, as we've already said, it is a general description of health of a healthy church environment. Keep in mind Galatians 6, 1, 2, and 3 as I read Ephesians 4, 1, and 2. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love. Now here he's not dealing directly with conflict or with correcting sin. He's just describing a healthy church environment, and he mentions lowliness and gentleness and patience and bearing with one another in love. These attitudes are not attitudes to be lived by except when someone does something wrong and we have to confront them. If ever these attitudes are needed, it is when someone does something wrong and we need to confront them. If ever these attitudes are needed, it is when someone has offended another. We've already established that whether in the world or in the church, there will be conflict. But this is the way conflict is to be handled in the church as opposed to the ways it is handled in the world. The last two verses of Ephesians 4 bring the description of a healthy church environment full circle. For there Paul writes, "Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you." If there is conflict and we want to make the conflict worse, it's easy to do. We just get rid of verses 31 and 32. We allow the evil speaking of each other. We get rid of the kindness and the tender hearts. But those who walk worthy of their calling will bring kindness. They'll bring tender hearts. They will not speak evil of others, especially not behind their backs, which is malice. If someone is involved in sin, kind and tender hearts will not say that the sin doesn't matter. In anybody, illness, especially spiritual illness, must be treated. But going back to Galatians 6, it is to be treated in a spirit of gentleness. And this is one where I can't say that one translation here is just a little bit clearer than another. In Galatians 6, verse 1, the NIV says, "Restore that person gently." The New King James and the English Standard both have, "Restore that person in a spirit of gentleness." In this case, the NIV is simply wrong. Gently will be an accurate description of how a person is confronted, but that says less than what Paul said. Gently will deal with an action. Having a spirit of gentleness involves more than doing it gently. Doing something gently only describes the outward action. A spirit of gentleness describes the heart of the person doing the confronting. Jesus said, "Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks," in Matthew 12:34. The heart of the person doing the correcting needs to have been conditioned in the environment of Ephesians 4, verse 2. Otherwise, he's going to be greatly tempted to say wrong things in the wrong way. If we have a church environment of lowliness and gentleness and long-suffering and bearing with one another, the entire conversation of Galatians 6, 1 is going to be much more productive of good things. The passage that presents the most complete and detailed way to address conflict in the church comes from Jesus himself back in Matthew chapter 18. Reading in Matthew 18, verses 15, 16, and 17, Jesus says, "Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector." Before digging into the details of these instructions, there are a couple general ideas that we must clarify. One of the first questions that is often asked when the subject of conflict between brethren arises is, who is to make the first move toward reconciliation? Is the person who is offended supposed to confront the offender, or is it the offender who has the first responsibility to ask for forgiveness? Here in Matthew 18, verse 15, we see the offended acting first. But if that is a hard and fast rule, then Jesus contradicted himself, because this is what he says back in Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 and 24. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. So there is no hard and fast rule. The question isn't really who should go first. The real question is who will go first. And the answer is, the one who cares the most will go first. Another popular misunderstanding with Matthew 18 is that it is primarily about what we call church discipline. Now, the general principles involved here would probably be good for church leaders to follow if they are dealing with a wayward member. The idea of one or two people approaching the person and then a couple of more intervening before making the situation more public, definitely good advice, worthy of consideration. But that is not the primary context or application of this passage. It's not what he's talking about. This is primarily a problem between two brethren. When your brother sins against you is not when the church is concerned about the sins of a member. Every time the pronouns you and your are used in verses 15, 16, and 17, they are always singular. They are referring to the person who has been offended. Only in verse 18, after others have become involved, does Jesus switch and use plural pronouns. With that said, let's take a practical, real-life, almost step-by-step look at what Jesus says in verse 15 of Matthew 18. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him what he did that offended you. What's going to happen when you do that? Well, several different things could happen. But one thing that might happen is that you will learn that he didn't really do anything against you. Maybe you misunderstood what he did or said. He didn't express himself clearly, and there wasn't really anything to be offended by. Isn't that the best outcome of all? There was no offense, there was no wrongdoing involved, just a misunderstanding that was quickly resolved. That's why it is important that the first contact be between the people who are actively involved in the perceived problem. And notice that Jesus didn't even say, if your brother sins against you, go and tell the elders and have them go and tell him his fault. Jesus does not authorize us to farm out our responsibilities to someone else, not even the elders or the preacher. If there are problems, if there is conflict in a congregation, the elders have some responsibility to deal with it, and no one can do their job for them. But at the same time, the elders cannot fulfill your responsibility in your place. Years ago, I wasn't here at the time, but years ago I had a situation where someone took a complaint about me to an elder. The elder then brought the complaint to me, but wouldn't tell me who the complaint came from. How was I supposed to resolve an issue with the person if I didn't know who the person was? Complaining about someone instead of taking the complaint to the person is not conflict resolution. That's gossip. The person who is complaining and the person who is listening to the complaint and passing it along anonymously are both guilty of gossip, and that whole situation is incompatible with the church environment that we have been studying of lowliness, gentleness, patience, and bearing with one another in love. So you go to the source of the perceived offense and you explain your problem. And remember, you do this with humility and gentleness. You explain the problem, and sure enough, there's a problem. This is more than an misunderstanding. So you discuss it, and hopefully you work it out. If that doesn't work, then verse 16 comes into play. But let's not be too legalistic and say that if one conversation doesn't completely resolve the issue, that we are not allowed to give it a second try between just the two of us. It's not that hard and fast at all. We can give it a second try. It's not required that we bring others in if the first one just doesn't work. But if progress isn't made, then some more maybe objective, spiritually minded Christians might be able to help. There are at least two things that they might be able to do. One, they simply might be more successful than you were in convincing the person of his or her error. Sometimes the force of numbers does make an impact. Or another possibility, they might hear both sides of this issue and then tell you that you are making a mountain out of a molehill. Or, and then as a next step, if that still doesn't resolve things, the counsel and the encouragement of the whole church might be needed if things aren't progressing. And finally, if there is no resolution, you're better off just staying away from that person. And this is where the verse about two or three being together in my name comes into play. That's verses 18, 19, and 20. Assuredly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. You don't want to break off fellowship with another Christian all by yourself without the counsel of others. If you have to break off fellowship with a brother or sister in Christ, and multiple mature Christians agree that that is what you need to do, then you have the assurance that God accepts your decision. That is the context and the application of verses 18, 19, and 20. And we must remember that throughout this process, the goal is reconciliation. We're not trying to win an argument. We're not trying to prove someone wrong. We are trying to mend a damaged relationship between two members of the same body. Let's try to bring all of these ideas and passages together. We have these instructions in Matthew 18 about doing everything possible and getting all the help possible to restore a relationship. Or back in Galatians 6, we're doing whatever is needed to get a brother to repent of sins that could cost him his salvation. But these are not isolated actions. We aren't trying to mend relationships or save souls in a spiritual vacuum. To start with, we have this environment that is so important to whatever the church is trying to do. This is an environment of lowliness, gentleness, patience, and bearing with each other in love. This is an environment where bitterness and evil speaking are not allowed. We don't say such things and we don't listen to such things. It's an environment where we trust each other. We have learned that we can trust each other to be kind and tender-hearted and forgiving. In that environment, one of us does something that is wrong. In that environment, the one who has done wrong sees a brother or sister coming his way and pointing out the problem. In that environment, we sit down together to seek repentance or restoration or reconciliation. In that environment, we endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The church will never stand out from the world because we never have conflict. But the church can stand out from the world because of an environment that allows us to address our problems in a way that brings glory to God. Because His church is my church, we all share the responsibility for creating and maintaining and expecting this God-ordained church environment. If you are not a Christian, God calls you to live your life worthy of His calling. Believe in Christ, repent of your sins, be baptized into Christ. God will forgive you of your sins, and He will add you to His church, where people are striving to be the kind of church God wants us to be, God calls us to be. You won't be perfect. The people around you won't be perfect. But we have all answered the call, and we are here to help each other live the way God calls us to live. If you want to respond to that call this morning, come to the front while we're singing this next song.